Hi there, welcome to the new video. Today we'll be going through this paper, which is titled as HARP, Hierarchical Representation Learning for Networks. This paper is from Stony, Brook University, Google Research, and Yahoo Research, and it came out in the year of 2018. So let's start with the abstract. We present HARP, a novel method for learning low-dimensional embedding for graph nodes which preserve the higher-order structural features. Okay, so this is again one of the methods that learns low-dimensional representations for every node in a graph, just like DeepWalk and Node2Vec, which we have already seen in the series of ML with graphs, while preserving the structural features. Okay, so their method compresses the input graph prior to embedding it to avoid any local minimas, which can pose problems for non-convex optimizations. Okay, so the earlier methods such as DeepWalk and Node2Vec were based on random walks, where from every node you would spawn multiple small length walks and then pass it to obtain some linear chains, and then later on apply a word-to-vec algorithm, which is based on skipgram, let's say, to get the node representations. So again, in that case, because of sampling low-length random walks, the system just focuses on nearby words and forgets about longer dependencies that might exist in the graph, maybe let's say 5-6 hops onwards. So this method, which is HARP, essentially compresses the input graph by doing some merge operations, then applying some embedding technique to learn representation at that level. And also, since they are doing for very less complex graph, so the chances for learning algorithm to get trapped at local minima would be very less compared to if the function had to converge in a complex loss landscape. So HARP works by finding the smaller graph which approximates the global structure of the input. So as you can see in this figure, if this was the original graph, which is something like ring architecture, HARP would essentially reduce the number of nodes and edges from the original graph, yet retaining the global structure, which is of ring. And similarly for this, if you see, you have something that resembles a square. So again, in this case, if you see HARP, it is relatively closer to a square distribution compared to if you see the other methods such as line. So with this, we see like it's kind of preserving the global structure with very less number of nodes and edges. This simplified graph is used to learn a set of initial representation which serve as a good initialization for learning representation in the original. We extend this idea by decomposing the graph in series of levels and then embed the hierarchy of graphs from coarsest one to the original one. Okay, so what they're saying is, let's say you have a graph G that had X edges and Y nodes. You decompose this graph into multiple levels of graphs where each of the level is successively smaller than the previous one. So let's call it G1, G2 till GK, where GK being the smallest graph out of all of these segments, and let GK have X by 2, comma Y by 2. These are the number of edges and nodes that the system has. They'll start learning representation for the nodes for this graph and later on propagate the embeddings learned for the nodes as the initializations for g of k minus 1, and then again learn embeddings for all of the nodes in this graph with the initializations from gk, and again you'll traverse back and you'll keep doing this till you get to g that has now learned the representations of every node by successively transferring the representations from the most coarsest one, which is a GK, to the more finer one, which was the G. So this transfer of initializations and learning the node embeddings helps the nodes to preserve the overall global structure for the graph. Okay. Lastly, they propose this as a general meta strategy to improve all of the state-of-the-art neural algorithms, such as DeepWalk, Line, and Node2Vec, approximately 14% of macro F1, when evaluated on classification task on all of these datasets. So yeah, again, they're not trying to propose an algorithm that will do an embeddings for you. Instead, this is one of the methods by which you can learn a better representation for the node by following this divide and conquer strategy. And this can very well be applied with all of the previous approaches such as line, DeepWalk, and Node2Vec. So mind you, this paper came out around in 2018. So all of these are some of the previous techniques that came before this. Okay, moving forward. So talking about problem formulation, let's say we have a graph G where all the vertices are given by the character V and edges by E. So the goal is to learn a mapping function phi that would translate every node V in some d-dimensional space where D is very, very less compared to the number of nodes that you have in that graph. So yeah, this is very much desirable because if D is equal to V, then you're doing nothing but just one hot encoding representation for every node. So you can have like a vector of V length, and for let's say V4 you have 0 0 0 1 then all of these are zero. So this again could be one of the representation which is very sparse. So to learn a representation which is very dense, you need to have D which is very much small compared to V. And most of the techniques that have been proposed so far have two main disadvantages. The first one is they do not preserve some higher order graphical structural information, which you saw like Node2Vec and DeepWalk only spawns short distance random walks, because of which they are not able to capture the longer dependencies or the global structure of the entire graph. So that is one. And secondly, the optimization can fall victim to the poor initializations. So again, in all those methods, you do not have any method of initializing the representation of nodes and might get wrapped in the local minima in that loss space. Okay. So the aim of the method that the authors propose is to find a graph GS, let's say, which has VS number of vertices and ES number of edges, where the count of VS is much smaller than the count of the original number of vertices that you had in the graph G, and similarly for the edges, because of which you'll have less pairwise relationship, resulting in lesser complexity, resulting in a smoother objective function, and would be easier for the optimizer to optimize on. Not only this, but also the diameter of GS will be much smaller than G. So for all of you who do not know what a diameter in a graph would mean, it is the maximum distance between any pair of vertices in that graph. So now if you merge edges and nodes, then chances are very high things will be closer to each other, so the diameter would decrease. But since the way you decrease the nodes and edges still preserve the global structure, so now any embedding algorithm with local focus such as Node2Vec and DeepWalk can exploit the global structure of the graph. Okay, so again what they are saying is, let's say you have a graph G and you do many bifurcations of this graph, and let's say you have GL at this point. So this graph is very much smaller. It has VS number of vertices and ES number of edges, which is very much small compared to the original graph, which had V number of vertices and E number of edges. So directly running any local focused algorithm such as DeepWalk or Node2Vec at this point would not capture the global structure of the graph and will just be limited by the nearby structures that occur in the vicinity of a certain node. But now if you apply those algorithms at this level, which is at GL level, since the diameter has become small and the graph is less complex, so those algorithms will be able to capture the global structure. You use that representation as an initialization for GL minus 1. You again initialize the previous graph, which is GL minus 2, with the embeddings that you have learned at GL minus 1. And you keep doing it till you get to the G level. So yeah, that is the entire idea. Now let's see the entire method to what they propose. How do they do the graph coarsening and how do they kind of do the initialization and extend the embedding space? So they have like 4 steps defined for this method. The first is called graph coarsening, which was kind of dividing every graph into multiple smaller segments that has lower number of edges and vertices. Then the next is to kind of do a embedding for that coarsest graph. Then the third step is to do a prolongation and refinement of the embeddings. So this is the transfer scheme of initializing the embeddings that you have learned at GL level to the nodes of G of L minus 1. And the fourth one is getting the embedding of the original graph. So let's see the algorithm. We have a graph G that has V number of vertices and E number of edges, and we are also given a function embed. Think of it as Node2Vec or DeepWalk algorithm that will essentially learn and output the embeddings for every node in that graph. So the output that you want the HARP model to generate is a function phi, which is nothing but a matrix which has V number of nodes, and the dimension that you want to represent every node is of D dimension. So the first step is to take the graph G and pass it to a graph coarsening function that will return multiple scaled down version of this graph by merging edges and vertices. So let's say we get L plus 1 graph, where GL is the graph that is most coarsest, or essentially has the minimal number of vertices or edges compared to all its variations. Then in step 2, we can see we initialize a phi dash GL to zeros. So this is an embedding that we assign to every node in that graph as an initialization. You pass those zero vectors for every node and the graph GL to the embed function, let this be Node2Vec, and you get a representation for every node in that graph. Now from point 4 to 6, you essentially do a loop from L minus 1 to 0th graph level. L minus 1 because you have already got the representation for the GL. So if you replace I with L minus 1, you will have phi of G of L comma G of L comma G of L minus 1. So now the embeddings that you have learned at GL minus 1 will act as an initialization for the node embeddings at GL level. So this get initialized, and then you use the initialized version and again pass it with the graph of GL minus 1 And again, you call the node 2x algorithm to get a final representation at g of l minus 1 level as well. Then again, this loop continues till you get to 0, which is g0, which is nothing but the entire graph g, from which we bifurcated multiple scaled down version of this graph. And at the end, we return the final embedding, which is phi of g0. So yeah, this is the entire algorithm, how it works. Now let's focus on multiple fragments where they are focusing on calling another function, such as graph coarsening and prolongate. So this algorithm talks about how the graph coarsening happens if given a graph G. It takes in a graph G that has V vertices and E edges. The idea is to produce an output which is a series of coarsened graph, let's say G0 to GL. Let's start with L is equal to 0 and assign G0 to be G. So considering the first coarsened graph to be G0, so this is nothing but the original graph. It has 200 vertices and they have used threshold to be 100. So if 200 is greater than or equal to 100, which means it holds true, then you increase the level. So now level becomes 1. You do a star collapse followed by an edge collapse function on the original graph G and get a new version of G for that level. So now at this position, you have G1. Now you check for what are the number of vertices that you have for G1. If it's greater than equal to threshold, then you again move and increase the L by 1. Now you have L is equal to 2. You again apply the collapsing function on the original G and calculate the number of vertices you have. You keep repeating this till this while condition holds false, which means the graph that you have at that level has number of nodes which is less than 100. And let's call it GL. Once you have obtained all of these graphs, you return from this function. Now let's see what star collapse and edge collapse mean. So talking about star collapsing, the first figure that you see is a kind of a star because you can see like all these blue colored peripheral vertices, and the central node, which is V7, is usually called hub in network terminology. And also you can see like for every peripheral node, the neighboring node is same, which is V7. So all of them are kind of sharing the same neighbor. So as you can see, we can have a master node, which is V12, that kind of merges V1 and V2, and similarly V34 and V56. So this is the merged version that you get that still more or less preserves a star architecture. So this is the idea behind star collapsing. Talking about edge collapse. So under edge collapsing, the idea is to collapse the edges that are not incident on any single common node. So here you can see we have three edges, this one, and this one. V12 and V13 cannot be merged because they have a common node, which is V1. But V12 and V3 are kind of independent and parallel. They do not share any common incident node. So you kind of merge these two and have a compressed representation, which is this. So this is how you do edge collapsing. But authors in this case, as we saw, were doing star collapsing followed by edge collapsing. Because if you just do edge collapsing in the cases of stars, for example, then you have all of these edges, right? And all of these are kind of have a common incident node, which is V7. So only one of the edges can be kind of merged. You can maximum reduce them to k-1 number of edges. So with this, you haven't made any significant reduction. So that's why you first apply star collapsing, that would kind of collapse this to search architecture. And then if required, you can go and do edge collapsing. Okay. Talking of the last step, which is embedding prolongation, which is we already have discussed, like you learn embedding for a higher or a coarser representation and then use that embedding as a initialization step for the more finer graph and then relearn the embedding, and you keep doing it till you get the representation for the original graph. So for example, if we consider the case of star, let's say, if this was a graph that we had, you apply node2x for this algorithm, you will get the representation for all of these four nodes. Let's consider this to be G2 and this to be G1. So idea of embedding prolongation kind of traverses back from G2 to G1. So for V7, since you already have an embedding, you initialize this embedding directly in the G1 case as well. But now as you can see, like V1 and V2 is a master node, which was formed by merging V1 and V2 separately. So the embedding for this node kind of gets divided and both of them are assigned the same embedding representation. So if V1 and V2 was 0.2, 0.3 and 0.4, for example, then both V1 and V2 will have same embedding vector. And similarly, V3, V4 will share the same embedding vector. So with this, you initialize, then again, you run node2x on this algorithm and you'll have final representation for every node. So yeah, this is the entire paper to what they discuss. Then they have experiments and baseline methods. So I think we are done with the paper now. So if you like my content, make sure you hit that like button and subscribe to the channel. And do share it with your friends if they are interested in such content. We are very close to 1,000 subscribers. Thank you for all your support. I'll meet you in the next one. Bye.